Good afternoon. Today I'm announcing an investment by St. Louis County of $4 million into technology support for virtual learning, online classroom learning for families that choose to do so. And I'm here in the Jennings School District because we need to recognize that online learning, virtual education is not easy for every family or every student. Like every complex issue we face in St. Louis County, we have to answer the question of equity. And we're here today to try and bridge the gap for those families that can't easily access online learning. We're going to partner with the St. Louis County Library System because they already have existing relationships with our school districts. They already have existing relationships with our superintendents, and they have been working on a pilot project to get technology in the hands of families to make sure that they can participate in a virtual classroom. I want to do all we can to eliminate the barriers to virtual education. I want to do this because, as I've said in the past week, I would recommend that every family who has an option for a virtual classroom to choose that option. Families who agree with that recommendation should not be limited by access to technology. Let's talk about where we are today. COVID cases are increasing. The virus is spreading in our community. Kids can and do get COVID-19. They can get sick. They can get in the hospital. They can lose their lives. Kids can also be asymptomatic. They can spread COVID-19 to their parents, to their grandparents, and to others. Virtual schools are a path to curbing the spread of this virus. And almost all the plans we've been talking about and hearing from our superintendents at least include a virtual option. All schools who have in-person options are watching the virus and the statistics very closely to make sure that they will be able to go through those plans in the coming weeks. St. Louis County has made some difficult decisions over the past few months, some tough decisions. We have to follow these guidelines. We have to follow the business guidelines, and we have to recognize that masks are mandatory in St. Louis County. If we adhere to these guidelines, however unpopular, including masking, then we have a chance that sometime this fall, kids will have a chance to be in an in-school setting. We have a chance to keep our businesses open. If we do not adhere to masking, we will continue to see the cases climb. In addition to restrictions on youth sports, in addition to restrictions on our businesses, last Friday, St. Louis County decided that they would stop issuing permits for graduations, for proms, or any other youth activity that allows gatherings. We do need to recognize as we prepare for school that we need to do everything we can to curb the spread of the virus among our young adults and everyone they interact with. I cannot stress enough how important it is if we work together on this. I'd like to recognize Dr. McCoy now to say a few words on behalf of the plans of the Jennings School District.
I would like to thank the St. Louis County Executive and St. Louis County for the support of $4 million to the region and to the students, which some of whom we have here and students across our entire metropolitan area. Also, I'm so thankful for our partners like the library, our corporate partners, and our physicians, being someone who's worked with them for the past 3 months on reopening and reentry plans. It is more difficult to close down than it is to reopen. And so I want to share that public schools are only as strong as its public. And school communities are only as safe as its community, be it public, private, or parochial. As the community's safety with COVID is seemingly to not be taken as seriously as needed to reduce the amount of people contracting, we need parents, we need adults, and we also need young people to educate themselves and to act accordingly in a way that has social distancing of 6 feet or more, masks, hand washing, hygiene, and more. We as a system have had students in school for almost a month now and have had first responders in a setting since April. And have not had any contractions of COVID within our school education settings. This proves that it is possible to do, but it also proves that behaviors must change and schooling will not be anything like it was before. We foresee that it will be quite different for the next 2 years into the 22-23 school year, where rapid testing, where you can get 5-minute results back, may be more accessible to every school, multiple times for every child, and a vaccine may be accessible at that time as well to all students. So we're prepared to do a few things. This money helps to support the 3 C's. That is more computer devices for every child to close the digital divide, more connectivity for broadband, and then ultimately more adult support as coaches, technical coaches, academic coaches for learning, and life coaches for this new COVID situation. Because truly, families have never had to educate their child from home using a public school curriculum or otherwise, unless you were homeschooling. Now, this is going to be a more vital part for all of our region as we keep our community and students safe. So I encourage educators to think about having all options of virtual online learning for sure, and then think about those students who may be in neglect or abuse situations, knowing that our abuse hotlines are increasing, and knowing that some children are in neglect situations if there's not a caring adult to take care of them, or our students with special needs. So that's why we must pilot things for our kids as soon as possible to learn the behaviors, keep things safe, and make sure that we reduce the spread and the transmission of COVID. I want to thank the leadership of St. Louis County, all of our physicians and first responders, and especially my educators who have become many of them contact tracers, over 30 of them, so that they know how to lead, how to prepare, and we are putting it in action. Our plans are not just plans, they are currently in action because we are studying, we are learning and planning, but we are also doing it. And in our doing, we want to make sure we do what's best for each and every one of our constituents. So again, I thank everyone involved for being a great part. I'd like to welcome at this time to the stage one of the key physicians, I believe, who's been a part of helping us to understand how serious COVID is and how serious it is that we protect ourselves.
Things like the opportunity for kids to learn in the classroom, even if on a part-time basis. make the decision easier, though, by all of us doing our part to keep transmission flow in the community. So those are my concluding remarks. I do want to thank Dr. McCord and Dr. Page for all their leadership in this in education, as well as around COVID in general. St. Louis County, St. Louis City, the metropolitan area. When you think about it relative to the rest of the country, we have done a good job. So I don't want to, offer us some encouragement. We have done a good job. But now is the time to turn it around. We can't do things like having a school in person if we can't turn this around. And it's just going to take the effort from the public.
Before we take questions, I want to recognize Kristen Swartz, who's the director of our County Public Library System. And let her tell us a little bit about the program.
Hello, I'm Kristen Swartz, and I'm the director and CEO of the St. Louis County Library District. And we are ready to assist students and their families during this humanitarian and economic crisis. These dollars will be used to address digital equity in the region by providing hotspots and Chromebooks to students in St. Louis County. In addition, the library will provide access to online resources that provide one-to-one live tutoring services to students in K through 12th grade. We are so grateful to St. Louis County for their generous support in helping address digital equity in our region. This pandemic has impacted all of our lives, but for young people and their family, it has been particularly devastating. Providing students with digital access will give them the tools they need to be successful in the coming school year and beyond. Thank you.
We can take some questions.
Dr. Page, with this announcement, sir, does this kind of infer, does it give school districts a nudge or suggestion that maybe we really should go all virtual?
Well, we certainly would recommend a virtual option for families whenever possible. And St. Louis County is prepared to support that decision for any school district that wants to do it. We need to watch how the cases develop in the next few days, the next few weeks, before we make any sort of firm assertion, but it would be our recommendation now that the trend that we're going in St. Louis County, that we would very likely be in a position where a virtual first semester is going to be where we'd be. If we don't get masks on everyone, if we don't get folks following strictly the business guidelines, if we don't see masks more widely adopted in our community, then it's going to be very difficult for any classroom.
So what do you say to the parents like at Rockwood? They've got a group now that's going to show up at the meeting tonight demanding their students are in class 5 days a week. What do you say to those parents?
Well, first of all, at this point, where we are with COVID in our community, we are referring to the superintendents to make a decision that gives our recommendation. My recommendation personally is a virtual option for parents to choose and for schools to work with their parents, work with their teachers to see if an in-classroom option is can be done safely with social distancing and masking. We also have to be, we are certainly concerned about the parents who are essential workers where virtual school doesn't work well for them. We also have to recognize that we are putting our teachers at risk if COVID-19 transmission continues to climb in our community and we create gatherings that are not optimizing social distancing for others. I would say to parents who are concerned and teachers who are concerned that this is a very difficult time in the history of our community, a place where we haven't been before. And if we do not get COVID under control, then we will have to take measures that are unpopular and are disruptive to everyone's lives. We will have to go backwards in our public health orders. Start to put more public health restrictions on activities in the community. If
Dr. Page, this is just a bit off of the school issue, but what kind of consideration are you or any other county health officials given to more restrictions or perhaps closing some bars, nightclubs where young people gather? You're seeing spikes in the 20 to 40 age group. What kind of consideration are you giving to any restrictions or closing?
We review all of our restrictions on a daily basis. And more restrictions on bars, more restrictions on restaurants going to dine out, carry out only, those are definitely on the table. And if we don't turn the tide on COVID in our community in the next week or two, then we're gonna be making some tough decisions. We need people to wear masks. We need to protect employees at bars and restaurants. We're monitoring them. We're reviewing complaints and violations. We're sending warning letters. We're monitoring their activity. Bars and restaurants have license, and because of that license, they are subject to rules and regulations of the county health department. We understand that we're in a tough spot historically. The virus is moving in our community. We do not have yet wide acceptance of masking, and because of that, that's one reason masking and gatherings, weddings, anniversaries, celebrations, class parties, the virus is moving about. We need to get it under control. We will definitely be moving back to the community.
One other question for maybe Dr. Page and Dr. Garza. The White House Coronavirus Task Force says it has sent messages to a number of cities and areas, including St. Louis, that the area needs to be more aggressive in bringing the COVID under control. Mayor Cruzan says she hasn't received a call from anybody at the White House about that aggressive approach. Have you or anybody in the county received any word from the White House? And Dr. Garza,
yeah, well,
you know
that, Dr. Garza can answer that too, but nobody in St. Louis County is in communication with the White House on that issue. We communicate on a regular basis with the State Department of Health and our regional health department partners, but we haven't gotten that message. But I do agree with that assessment, for sure. If we don't get widespread adoption of masking, if we don't see greater acceptance of our public health directives, then we are definitely heading in the wrong direction. And it will impact our ability to have in-person classes in schools.
Nobody from the White House contacted the pandemic task force yet?
No, we're straight.
Sure. Yeah, nobody from the White House contacted the pandemic task force, so we found out about it through the meeting.
I have a two-part question, probably for the county executive and the superintendent. So I think from my notes, Dr. Mars has already said the school year is in jeopardy for whatever can come. Even the last question was, there seems to be some type of rolling plan. If the obvious is so far in front of us right now that this could be detrimental, why not just take a bold stand and say, let's go all virtual? Why? I know it's a partnership. Maybe the superintendent has more weight when it comes to that and you have less, but why don't we just come with one accord and say, shut it down?
I think you're seeing school districts across the county making a decision based on the students that they serve and the particular needs of those students. How to balance the COVID in our community and the needs of some families for virtual school is very difficult. And we have to recognize that it's very difficult for some families, and that's why the county is stepping in with these technology funds. But I'll let Dr. McCoy answer that.
This is a complex situation. It is easier to close down than it is to open up. And there are different places that are asking for 5-day a week schooling, such as Rockwood, which I'm an alumni Lafayette and former resident of Rockwood. And there are other places that's the highest transmission zip code, like 61-36, where we are present. So that's why it's important to have actual action research showing that it's possible to do, but knowing what will happen, such as although we've opened up, we've had days with 30% attendance because you have to keep out those who have any symptoms. Every person who came here had their temperature checked, and some of you were kept out until you had a lower temperature and said you hadn't had any temperatures because you were just hot walking in. That happens and they don't get to come back in. And so that's a key learning. The other key structures are this. If you open up, you have to assume that COVID is in your building. So you have to have enough equipment, enough technology, and enough education and training to prevent the transmission of COVID from one kid to another or one adult to another who may be asymptomatic. It takes time and learning and action to do that, and that cannot be accomplished if you close all schools and make a decision to actually have no school incurred. There can be no pilot, there can be no action research, and there will be neglect and abuse from those who need us most. So it's difficult to make the cartilage decision, and it will be made when necessary to be made, but that's why there are statutes in place that ought to give the school districts the power to still continue schooling even if the building is closed, if it comes to that. To the opposite side of the argument, in my conversation with Dr. Miles this morning with the St. Louis Reentry Team for reopening schools, the suggestion was made by myself and physicians, Jason Newland and Rachel from WashU, the infectious disease specialists and others, to offer options, which Rocky was doing, and to even consider the possibility of one space doing 5 days a week to learn and pilot if it's possible to have the safeguards to prevent transmission. Because the bottom line is, we're in uncharted territory and every school needs to study, plan, and then do before they spread it to large groups of people.
Dr. McCoy, what about a lot?
And I think it is so part of my boss is asking to clarify. Why not just go back to lockdown mode now? I mean, I think you just explained it. Just go ahead and make it clear for people listening to all of us.
Well, maybe it's a good sound, but definitely. It's essential to not go to a total lockdown unless it's essentially necessary so that schools can pilot, practice, and practice doesn't make perfect. Practice makes behaviors permanent. In a lockdown situation with no schools, there is no pilot, there is no practice. And it's impossible to make the right behaviors be permanent.
Wanted to ask about the parents who both work and how they're going to handle this with their kids learning from home every day.
To the question of how the parents adapt, it was important to get information to parents as early as possible. For instance, our district shared our plan as early as the 1st of June, others in mid-July. But it's also important that schools listen to parents and try to pilot plans to meet the needs of their communities. So in our district, for instance, we have pre-K through third grade coming daily. We have fourth grade through 12th grade coming every other day. And we have everyone who needs to have a virtual option with computer device, broadband connectivity, and life coaches, the C3Cs, to coach them on how to educate and how to move in life during COVID. It's incumbent on every school system to listen to those parents, have a process that allows for some service for those parents, because we're public servants paid by tax dollars. And ultimately, if firefighters, police officers, EMT responders, and others still have to go out and respond, in addition to essential workers like custodians who've done a wonderful job saving our life, then it's incumbent on us to do something. But we want to make sure we are technically able to do that well without killing anyone or reducing the amount of deaths. It's no secret that young children have died less often, but everyone is still at risk. And so we want to serve our children, serve our families, and it's going to take time for schools to learn how to do that appropriately.
I have a question. Let's talk about the zip codes. I know we keep going on with Dr. Norris and said the school year is in jeopardy, but the Rockwood School District, that zip code over there, that has the highest cases of COVID numbers right now. So why not just say, hey, you guys are in bad shape, let's shut you down quickly here. I understand you just said there's certain rules and procedures in place, but you have this group over here, the cases are high, and that zip code, and I don't understand for this zip code, but talk about that a little bit, because that might be a number of arguments as well.
So I think we have to first recognize that the schools that are offering in-classroom that may able to offer in school classrooms, and we're not sure yet if anyone before COVID goes, but that will be a possibility 4 weeks from now. But the ones that do that will do that with greatly reduced classes. Great, it's not going to be the crowds that folks are used to seeing in schools. So the question before us is, in a greatly reduced
classroom, regularly reduce volume of school, and social distancing measures be implemented that would be safe for the kids. No one's going to do anything that isn't safe for the kids. And we have to recognize the balance between keeping kids from falling behind and getting them online, getting this working smoothly with the needs of the parents. It's a very difficult balance. Everyone is going to be presented with a challenge that is a struggle and inconvenience for a lot of families. We're going to have to work through that together. But as we see COVID spreading in the community, the option of in-school classes is going to be much more difficult. But what will happen in the fall, if there are in-school classes, will be at a greater reduced volume, and that does present an opportunity to create a system that is safe for kids and parents and teachers. And we're not yet ready to say today, absolutely, that we're not going to allow some of these other possibilities to be discussed. And that's where we are. We're talking about what the fall might look like, and we need to have these discussions because we're going to be dealing with COVID for a long time. To understand where and when is it possible to have reduced classes in school.
Is there a threshold you're looking at when number of cases, number of hospitalizations, whatever, where you'll pull the trigger and say, all got to be online?
There are many variables in the decision to close things down. We look at a lot of things. We look at testing availability, how fast are those testing results coming back to us, because an available test does not have much value if you can't get it, the test results in a couple of days. We'll be looking at our hospital capacity, but also our ICU capacity. If our hospitals are starting to increase, if we're doing, if this is a younger population, we aren't getting up in the ICUs as much, that becomes a variable. There are a lot of pieces that go into this, but I'd say we still may be looking at hospital admissions, ICU admissions. We'll be looking not just what happens in St. Louis County, but what's happening in our surrounding counties, because they also will be simply using our hospital facilities. And that will also be some added pressure. So we'll be talking to everybody. We'll be working very closely with the pandemic task force. We'll be following the advice of our public health officials. As of today, I can't say it's this number or that number. I can tell you that 40 admissions a day in hospitals is alarming. And if we stay on that trend, it's going to be very difficult for us to keep doing what we're doing.
Let me ask you, so you talk about inconvenience and struggle. I understand this was given some helpful technology, but for those folks who have kids who are at home, is there any kind of care that you can give to those people who are struggling with our child care? Some people have to learn two jobs, just talk about that.
Right, so this is not easy. This pandemic is a very difficult time in the history of our county, the history of our community, and it puts a lot of pressure on public health, puts a lot of pressure on humanitarian relief, really, and that's why the county has directed its resources appropriately to food distribution networks, to rental support, mortgage support, the basic needs, humanitarian needs of a family that might struggle. We have set aside in our budget $5.9 million for support for daycares. And, we know that without daycares, it makes it very difficult for people to go back to work. And the same impact on our schools as well. The school is a place where young kids go and stay by themselves. And that's part of this conversation. The first priority of county government is to keep people safe and look out for their welfare. That's where we start. And then we see how can we address all these other challenges, humanitarian and economic challenges that are very important part of people's everyday lives. How do we address those as well? Keep the kids safe, keep the teachers safe, and then what can we build around that addresses these other concerns that are very real and very important.
Let me ask another. The conversation is always the struggle about learning, but with the sports, that has been a big conversation in my newsroom this morning. But I talked to your office about it, get out of it. There was an announcement last week, there was an announcement today. Under the current guidelines, impacts for summer sports? What's the impact for fall sports with regards to school? Because football would normally be practicing. So can they not practice? Can they just start meeting? Like, how does that all come?
Before we talk about fall sports, but the guidelines that were presented by the Sports Medicine COVID-19 Task Force and unanimously adopted by that task force, adopted by St. Louis County, adopted by the City of St. Louis, all are in agreement, and they all are in agreement that social activities around sports are at risk for further spread of COVID-19 in our community and put our kids, put our parents and their families at risk. And those are social activities, team meetings, sports that draw fans. The guidelines for sports currently are limited practices with certain conditions. And that's for fall sports in the schools. I'll turn to Dr. Ford.
County Executive Spotlight, we're in phase one where you have 10 to 1 ratio, 1 coach, 10 students at any time, no spectators. 10 youth doesn't allow you to do football. I want to emphasize that sports is the toughest thing to really address during COVID. It's tougher than really a school setting situation because you have heavy breathing and it's hard to breathe wearing a mask. You have an object that someone, everyone touches the same object. And so literally schools are putting in place plans like basketball, which looks like one person shooting and getting their own rebound. That's not basketball, that's farce. And so wearing a mask while running, which we've practiced all these things with our students who are in session. Sports is going to be difficult. You also have Misha who's made the rule that if you've gone virtual, you cannot participate in competitive sports. So districts like Ferguson, Florissant, and Hazelwood right now don't have any students who are eligible to participate in these sports because of the option of going 100% virtual. If a school chooses to do so, then they forfeit that opportunity for their children to play and compete as a part of Misha. But we're in phase one. Limited interaction, limited numbers of students, no games, only workout kind of drills, and regular cleaning of every device that's been touched, every ball or object.
Did you say if they choose, the parents choose for their child to go virtual?
If the school system chooses to go 100% virtual, then the mission rule is that the child cannot participate if they attend that school, and that includes private and parochial, so other schools or included all schools. Is only virtual, then you do not qualify to play competitive sports under the mission rules.
But what if I want to keep my kid virtual? Can I still keep my kid on the team, or do I also forfeit my kid?
Yes, the school system has the power to keep the child on the team, have the child be virtually educated, and then once the school system does some in person, then they can resume. So you're not eliminated from the team, you just cannot participate.
Dr. McCoy, how many, going back to the $4 million, how many of your students will be impacted by this, and talk about that a little bit?
So this $4 million allows Virginians to receive somewhere in the range of $200,000 to possibly $500,000 maybe. With $500,000, every child can have hotspot broadband connectivity with the highest level of support for the entire school year. They could also have a touch screen device and or iPad type device for preschool through like second grade, which is a part for your young learners. It also helps with making sure that everyone has a one-to-one situation where there's one device that can go home for each child. And that's the beauty of this time. Schools have never provided 100% equity. We've always provided access and adequate education, things free, appropriate education, adequate education. COVID is forcing us to provide equity, which means everyone gets what they need according to the level of need. It's going to be up to us to have coaches in a life coach sense, academic coaching, technology coach sense, that work with parents to create an environment in their home that's conducive for learning. But I also think it's incumbent on us as school districts. We have a licensed child care facility in our school district. Other school districts do as well. It's up to those systems to provide child care for their families as needed, even if the school is closed for an extended period of time. That's why we're public service. We're here to serve. So there's two categories. One category is going to reduce liberties in order for more people to live. The other category is going to actually kind of have their life and have their life safety a little bit less safe in order for others to have the liberty to live. And so those teachers dedicated to coming in, which we have some here now, have made a choice to reduce the odds of being totally safe and in isolation so that others can actually live. And others will have options to reduce their access and liberty so that they can live those who live. We need both. It's not an either or, it's a both and to the degree that your community needs the support that you question. So the school systems have done a great job planning this whole summer, and I believe with the right amount of support and encouragement, there'll be the adequate calibration to help us through the next two school years where we'll be dealing with these types of new realities.
Yeah, I can see the county's concerned about the school, the social distancing, private business, all that. What do you say to protesters who are out protesting? A lot of them aren't wearing masks, or they might need some kind of face covering, but it's not adequate. Are you concerned about that if you are school zone?
Yeah, anybody out in the crowd should have a mask on. 6 feet away, and wear a mask. No matter what you're doing, inside or outside, if you're closer than 6 feet to someone, then you should have a mask on to protect yourself and, more importantly, protect others.
But you have the power to shut down the schools, but you don't have the power to shut down the protest. That's what some people are concerned about.
Well, we want to do it. We will continue to monitor the protests. We will continue to ask our protesters to wear masks. And the most recent protests, we have seen a much wider adoption of masks, and we will continue to make that request. If we don't see wide adoption of masks, we'll have a conversation about it. Early on in this pandemic, mask wearing was not quite as uniform. We've seen it a lot more in our community. We've seen it a lot more among protesters in our community. And we hope that continues if there is a need for any sort of administration.
Hey, so just a couple of questions related to some masks. One is about the governor and his elections to close the mask mandate statewide. What do you think that is?
Well, we're seeing more and more statewide mandates in our country. And statewide mask mandate would help us here in the region. Because there are other jurisdictions that are struggling, even at greater rates than ours here in St. Louis County. But this continues to grow across our state, and a statewide mandate would help us break the LLM.
You do hear people pushing back against masks. We've seen that in the press lately. Do you see that as a local minority, or how would you represent the minority?
Well, more and more people are accepting the masks across the country. It initially was, unfortunately, a partisan issue. And as we have seen wider acceptance among elected officials in both parties, then we see the mask acceptance grow more. It will continue to grow. More and more people adopt masks. People who hesitate to wear masks usually drop their hesitation when they see wider spread of COVID in their community. What we need to do in our community is get masks more widely adopted before we get into trouble. Because once we make a public health decision, whether it's wearing a mask or abiding by our public health orders or new public health order with restrictions, it takes 2 weeks for us to see the benefit of that intervention. That's the replication cycle of this virus. So when we get masks on everyone, it'll be 2 weeks before we see the benefit of that. We're approaching 2.5 weeks, almost 3, of a mask mandate in St. Louis County. We believe that will then occur. We just don't know if it will be enough. We'll have to think of more extraordinary measures. But the mask mandate will definitely help. Masks are becoming more widely accepted across the country. When COVID reaches a level of tolerance that triggers someone's resistance to wearing masks, unfortunately, it's
is it pretty much a warning to people that if we don't get our act together in 1 to 2 weeks, we're going to have to roll things back?
Well, I think everybody is saying that across the country. The White House is saying that. And we're saying that here in St. Louis County. If we don't get